In Jesus' name we pray. If the church is still there, I said, in Jesus' name we pray. Heavenly Father, we bless your name. We thank you because you brought us together into your presence. And in your presence, Lord, I pray you fulfill the good desire of everyone in Jesus' name. And I pray that you'll touch every life. Turn us around. Transform our lives. And we pray that your will, your purpose will be fulfilled in every life, in every family, in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. I'm reading from Psalm 16 and verse 11. Psalm 16 and verse 11. It says, thou wilt show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. And at thy right hand, there are pleasures forevermore. I pray that this verse will be fulfilled in every life in Jesus' name. We thank God for our pastors, our fathers and mothers in the Lord. And we thank the Lord for our leaders and workers. And I thank the Lord for myself for being here. And it says in that verse, look at it, in thy presence, this fullness of joy. I've been trying to emphasize to people everywhere that when we come to the presence of the Lord, we should be conscious that in the presence of the Lord, there should be joy. There should be joy for the sinner that comes, that the sins are washed away and wiped away. There should be joy for those who are sick, that the power of God is giving free flow. And it flows into their lives, and there is joy when they are healed. Those who have been in oppression, incarceration, in imprisonment, they come. And the power of the Lord gets into their lives, and there is joy because they are delivered. And then the members of the church will be in everywhere, in our homes, or on the crossroads, in temptation, trial, and difficulties and challenges that we have. And we come to the presence of the Lord. Our desire, our hope is that all the things we have faced in the town, in the city, as we come to the presence of the Lord, he'll roll everything away and there'll be joy today in Jesus' name. Our members, our workers, our leaders, our families, families that have problems, when they come to the presence of the Lord, there should be joy in the presence of the Lord. The pastor too, the preacher, the evangelist, the leader in the church ought to have joy. As we come and as I come, you need to understand that there should be joy for the preacher, for the pastor. If you respond very well, if you do what is right, if you obey the word of God, I should have joy in service. And so when you come to the service, you ought to understand the man standing there is in the presence of the Lord, and his right as well as his privilege is that he should have joy. But if you turn things upside down, this way, that way, and every time he comes, he doesn't have joy, you're not in the will of God. And so I want us to understand as a church, that you come to the service of God, every action, every reaction, every response, everything we do should bring joy to the person near you there. Should bring joy to the singer, joy to the orchestra, joy to our youth, and joy to the newcomers, joy to everybody. And then the last but not the least, joy to your pastor. I pray the pastor will have joy over you in Jesus' name. We're coming to 1 John chapter 3, and I'm reading from verse 1. 1 John chapter 3, and I'm reading from verse 1. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. You'll find in that verse 1, it talks about the sons of God. Those are the children of God. Those are the believers. I'm reading verse 8. In verse 8, it says, he that committeth sin is of the devil. For the devil sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, tell me what follows there. the Son of God was manifested that he might destroy the works of the devil. In verse 1, the sons of God in the plural. And then in verse 8, he talks about the Son of God, that is Jesus Christ, our Savior, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, Jesus Christ, the perfect sacrifice, Jesus Christ, our substitute. He went to the cross so that he can bear our sin. He can bear our shame. He can bear our suffering. That those of us who have been far away from the Lord, as Jesus Christ, the Son of God, went to the cross, he makes us to come near. Our sins are forgiven. And he makes us who are children of the devil, he makes us the sons of God. Put it this way. The Son of God came from heaven so that the sons of the children of the devil will be transformed and changed, and then we will go to heaven with him. That's the whole kind of a message you have in chapter 3, 1 John, verses 1 to 10. Let me read to you. It says, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life, that now we shall be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. The people God appreciates, the world depreciates. The people God loves, the world hates. And the people God brings near, the world drives far away, because it knew him not, and therefore he knows not. It says in verse 2, beloved, now are we the sons of God. When are we going to be the sons of God? Now in this present world. He forgives our sins now. He gives us peace now. He makes the change in our lives now. He turns us to new creatures now. He gives us eternal life now. He brings us into salvation now. Now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be. But we know. Thank God I know. I say thank God I know. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. And every man that has this hope in him purifies himself. How? I said how? Even as he is pure. You find many people, they don't compare themselves with Jesus. They compare themselves with, you know, somebody they know in the world. I'm better than that one. I'm like that one. But you're not compare yourself with anybody in the world, because it says every man that has the hope of the rapture, the hope of being in heaven, and the hope of living with God forever and ever, it says every man that has this hope in him purifies himself even as he is pure. Now he talks about being pure, and he's going to say if there's something in your life there, then you are not pure enough for the rapture. It says whosoever committeth sin transgresses also the law. For sin is a transgression of the law. And ye know that he was manifested to take away our sins. And in him is no sin. He's talking about Christ. He's the only one, because he was spotless, because he was sinless, because he was pure, because he was perfect, because he never yielded to any temptation. He had no penalty. He had no punishment. He had nothing to pay for. Because he was totally holy, completely holy and righteous and perfect, he is the only one that can sacrifice for our sins. He is the only one that can pay a penalty, because he doesn't have any penalty to pay. That's why it says we know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him is no sin. Whosoever abideth in him, he has not believed in Christ, he has come into Christ, he's staying in Christ, and he's sustaining his Christian life in Christ, he abides in him, sinneth not. Whosoever sinneth has not seen him, neither known him. Anybody who says, I'm born again, but they're still sinning. Anybody who says, I'm born again, and their past life is still what they are living. I'm born again, and all that we find is defilement and transgression and sin and evil, outwardly, inwardly, everywhere, in their families, in their offices, everywhere. Anyone who says, I'm born again, and still living in sin, he has not seen him, neither does he know him. Little children, verse 7, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. He that committeth sin is of the devil. Doesn't matter who he is. He calls himself a leader, calls himself a pastor, calls himself a superintendent, calls himself an overseer, whatever the title and whatever the name of the church or denomination. It says he that committeth sin is of the devil. He commits sin privately. He commits sin secretly. He commits sin habitually. He commits sin deliberately. He commits sin like the common people everywhere. He that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, for this reason, it says, because of this, that the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Thank God, he has the power to destroy all the works of the devil in your life. He will do it. Because if that is not done, there's no way you can go to heaven with all the works of the devil, all the property of the devil, all the character of the devil, all the attributes of the devil, and all the nature of the devil there. It must be destroyed. That's why it says, for this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whosoever is born of God, wonderful. Somebody help me shout wonderful. Does not commit sin. You see, the power comes to him. The assurance comes to him. The grace of God comes to him. And it's whosoever, a man, a woman, whosoever, married or not married, whosoever, a new convert, an old timer, whosoever is born of God does not commit sin. For his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin. He cannot sin. He cannot sin because he's born of God. In this the children of God are manifest, and the children of the devil. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. I've read those verses to you to show you what we are talking about. The believer's glorious freedom from sin is a glorious freedom. It's a wonderful freedom. You understand, the coming of Christ brought a glorious era. The coming of Christ to this world brought a glorious dispensation, higher than that of the Old Testament, greater than that of the Old Testament, better than that of the Old Testament. You understand? If we are still going to be like the Old Testament people, they fell and were falling, they sinned and were sinning, and they were evil and were still evil, and they could never maintain, they could never retain the blessing of God, always up and down, falling, arising, rising and falling. If we are still going to be like them, there'll be no point that Jesus would have come. You see, in their own case, they had forgiveness, then they went back, then they had forgiveness again, they went back, they had forgiveness again. In their own case, they said they had redemption, and they had the covering of their sin. Some of them were even cleansed, as David prayed, cleanse me from my sin, and wash me to make me whiter than snow. But if we're still at their level, the same atonement of the blood of animals, if the atonement of Jesus Christ cannot go beyond the atonement of the blood of animals, where did he come? If the salvation we have is not even up to their salvation, the righteousness we have is not up to their righteousness, the divine favor that we have is not even up to theirs, where is Calvary? What's the reason for Calvary? But you see, the reason Jesus came is so that believers will have a glorious freedom from sin. We have a better covenant, and that better covenant is based upon better promises. We're told in Hebrews chapter 8. Hebrews chapter 8, and I'm reading from verse 6. It says, but now, as he obtained a more excellent ministry, is comparing the ministry of Christ, is comparing the sacrifice of Christ, is comparing the result and the outcome of what Christ came to do, is comparing that with the Old Testament, and is saying, but now, as he obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also is the mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises. So then, as Christ has come, he brought in something better. He brought him something greater. He brought him something higher. And that is why now we can say by the grace of God, there is conversion and cleansing goes along with that. There is redemption and freedom goes along with that. He has come and he gives us a new heart. He gives us the divine nature. He gives us purity. He gives us holiness. He gives us sanctification. He gives us the endowment of power, the baptism in the Holy Ghost. And he gives us sonship. And he gives us an heavenly inheritance. If we lived like the generality of the Old Testament people lived, we would make Calvary unnecessary. We would make Calvary ineffective. We'll make Calvary vain. And it is because of this we're looking at what Christ has done, what he did for us on Calvary. And he came to lift us up. He came to raise us up. He came to lift us higher than the Old Testament people. And I pray that the marks of this new thing that Christ has done will be seen in every life in Jesus' name. Give me a good amen. The believer's glorious freedom from sin. Glorious freedom from sin. We're looking at 3 points. Number one, the marks of transformed sons of God. The marks of transformed sons of God. Sons of God that come to the Lord. And they're referred to by God himself. They're referred to by Christ that now we're transformed, now we're changed, now we're converted. We're sons of God. There are marks. There are evidences that shows that because this is your life and this is there and this is there, these are the identifying marks of the sons of God who are transformed. Point number two, the manifestation of the Savior from glory. The manifestation of the Savior from glory. He came from heaven for a purpose. He came from glory for a purpose. He came from the very presence of God to this evil world for a purpose. He came from where he was ruling over the angels. And he came to this place where they trampled on him, where they insulted him, where they pushed him, where they crucified him, where they betrayed him, and where they killed him. He came for a purpose. And it was manifested for that purpose. And we're going to see that the manifestation of the Savior from glory. Point number three, the marvel of true salvation with godliness. The marvel of true salvation with godliness. Number one. Tell me number one. You're not very sure. Number one. The marks of transformed sons of God. How do we know the sons of God? Apart from what they say. Apart from their testimony, how can you look at somebody and say, that's a child of God? How can I look at somebody and say, this is one of them that John the Beloved by the Spirit said, behold now, are they the sons of God now? Are we the sons of God? How can your husband tell that you have become a daughter of God? How can your wife tell you become a child of God? How can your parents tell that you have become a child of God? How can your teachers in school, how can fellow students, how can other people say, he's different? We see some marks, we see the evidence. This is a child of God. How can your neighbors who have known you for a long time, they knew you long ago before you said you accepted Christ and you believed in Christ, and they knew your character at that time, and they see you now, and as they look at the difference between then and now, they say, this is a child of God. What are the marks they see? We're coming back to 1 John chapter 3 verse 1. Behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us. They are the people who have understood the love of God. They are the people who have kind of taken John chapter 3 verse 16. They have personalized it. They have known that God loves them. And because God loves them in particular, he sent Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary to die for them in particular. They have received that. They have believed that. And that believing of the love of God has done something upon them. It's like it's bestowed personally on them. And it says that we shall be called the sons of God. That the Almighty God will look at them and say, that's mine. The angels will say, those are sons of God. And the neighbors will say, it's not like us anymore. It's a son of God. And the Christians, the believers who know the Bible, and those believers interact with us in business. They interact with us in conversation. They interact with us in manner of life. And they say, there is no doubt, no shadow of doubt at all. This is a real son, a real daughter of God. Behold, now are we the sons of God. In this present evil world, in the place of temptation, in place of trial, in the marketplace, in the place where they're pushing them here and there, our behavior, our comportment, our lifestyle shows that even now in this era, this generation of temptation and evil, now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And remember what Jesus said, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Because now our hearts are purified, because now our lives are transformed, that's why it says we shall see him as he is. And then it says, every man that has his hope in him purifieth himself even as he is pure. In verse 6, whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. That's a mark. That's a mark. Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. In verse 7, little children, let no man deceive you. And he that doeth righteousness is righteous. He actually practices righteousness. He does righteousness. He calculates. He looks at his life. He looks at his situation. Temptations there, trials there, difficulties there, challenges there, criticism there, and the confrontation there. And deliberately, he does righteousness. In the family, he does righteousness. It's not like, you know, he's unconscious and you know, just behaves anyhow. He's conscious that I'm a child of God. And whatever other people do, however other people live, in a conscious manner, in a deliberate manner, in an habitual way, in a determined way, he doeth righteousness. Those are the marks. The people who know, because I'm different, I cannot act like them. Because I'm different, I cannot eat what they are eating. Because I'm different, I cannot drink what they are drinking. Because I'm different, I cannot behave the way they are behaving. So deliberately, he doeth righteousness, even as he is righteous. How did all this begin? We're looking at John chapter 1. John chapter 1. I'm reading from verse 12. John chapter 1, verse 12. It says in verse 12, but as many as received him, you see, that's the mark. They've heard about Jesus. They've learned about Jesus. They've known Jesus, and they know that he came to save us. And as they saw that he came to die for us, on that basis they received him. As many as received him, to them he gave power, he gave the right to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. These are people who have heard the word of God and the Lord himself talking to them directly. You know, there's something for you. It's something for you to hear the word of God through the preacher, the word of God through the singers, the word of God through the Bible. It's another thing for the word from the Bible to jump into your heart as if God was standing in front of you and is talking to you directly. And you know that even if others did not hear, God himself is talking to me. And what's the Lord telling me? 2 Corinthians chapter 6. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, reading from verse 17, wherefore, come out from among them. Here you picture yourself, God is standing before you. You are standing before God. And he's saying, you want to become my child? You want to be referred to son of God by me, by Christ, by the Holy Ghost, by the angels, by heaven, and by the people of God? It says, this is what you'll do. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separate, says the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and I will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. If that has not happened, just saying I believe does not make it so. If this has not happened, that you have heard from the Lord, the Lord has confronted you, you have encountered the Lord, and he has said, come out. It may require that, you know, you have been in a secret cult, you have been in occultism, you have been in a relationship with a man, with a woman, with a boy, with a girl, and that relationship is contrary to the word of God. And it says, no matter how intimate you are, and no matter what pleasure you derive out of that, God says, this is not of me, this is not my desire, and this is not my plan for any of my creatures. This is sinful, and this is not proper, and therefore it says, come out from among them. You are deriving some finance there. Come out from among them. You are deriving some kind of a benefit there. All the same, God is saying, that is sinful. That's darkness. That's evil. And it says, come out and touch not the unclean thing. It says, only then. It is that repentance that then makes you a real child of God. And when you become a child of God, the Spirit of God will bear witness in your heart. He knows the transaction that has taken place. He knows the repentance that has taken place. And he knows the transformation that has taken place. And the Spirit of God will bear witness in Galatians chapter 4. Galatians chapter 4, reading from verse 6. And because ye are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. You feel it in your soul. You know it in your heart. It is not just mental assent. This is not just head knowledge. Because you came out, you know how genuine your repentance is. And you have looked at Calvary, and Calvary has washed away all your sins. And the Spirit of God now comes to you, the Spirit of his Son, in your heart. And is crying, Abba, Father. He says, wherefore, thou art no more a servant, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. There's an assurance within the heart that confirms that the Spirit of God is saying, that's a child of God. That's real repentance. That's real transformation. That's a real change. It's in Christ. It's a new creature in Christ. In Romans chapter 8, verse 14. Romans chapter 8, verse 14. It says, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the, tell me, the sons of God. And now what do you think about that? As many as are led by the Spirit of God. Let's say, for example, you have been, you know, every night you'll go to the lotto center, you'll go to the gambling center, and now you say you are born again, and the Spirit of God has taken control of your life. As many as are led by the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God is not going to lead you back into that gambling center. Never. Let's say, for example, you have been, you know, visiting nightclubs every time, and that has been your habit, but now you heard the gospel, and you heard about repentance, and you heard about regeneration, transformation, salvation in Christ. When that salvation has taken place, your life is handed over unto the Lord. And as many as are led by the Spirit of God is not going to lead you back into that nightclub. They are the sons of God. You have been in partnership with somebody, and the partnership is to go and rob, is to go and steal, is to go and do evil, and your name was there in their register, and you're always attending their meeting where you plan all those evil things. Now you have heard the gospel, you are born again, you're a real child of God. The Spirit of God has taken over where your feet go, where your eyes look at, and what things you are touching, and what things you are taking. Now the Spirit of God is not going to lead you back into that evil assembly. It's not going to lead you back into that sinful place. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Understand? If the spirit of the age is still leading you, if the spirit of the world is still leading you, if the spirit of Satan is still leading you, if the spirit of the natural man, of your natural depraved nature, is still leading you, if the old life of habit, of hunger, of fighting, of violence is still leading you, if all your habits of the past is still leading you, no, you are not a child of God. Only those whose lives have been taken over now by the Spirit of God. And it says, as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. God. And you will know that leading from the inside. And it is not just one in the public. It's not just because my wife is there, therefore I cannot, you know, talk like this to another woman because she's be asking, what's that? What are you discussing? Is that you are talking with? Whether your wife is there or not, the Spirit of the Lord does not only lead when your wife is there, when your husband is there. The Spirit of the Lord does not only lead when we're in the church here. In your office, the Spirit of the Lord is leading. Anywhere you are, the Spirit of the Lord is leading. And he may tell you in your heart, you're a child of God now. A child of God cannot go there. A child of God cannot sign that. A child of God cannot do that sort of thing. As many as are led like that, continually, anything you want to do, anything you want to say, anywhere you want to go, any friendship you want to keep, any relationship you want to keep, as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God and the daughters of God. To look at Philippians chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 15. Philippians chapter 2, reading from verse 15, that ye may be blameless and harmless as the sons of God. See that, harmless, you cannot harm anybody. You are very thoughtful in your behavior. You are very thoughtful in your action. Whatever you say that will harm another person, whatever you say that will destroy another person's life, whatever you say that will destroy their family, you cannot do that anymore now. The Spirit of God is saying, hold on before you say that. If somebody said that to you, how do you feel? Hold on before you do that. If somebody did that to you, how would you feel? Hold on before you act that way. If somebody acted like that to you, how does it affect your life? Then you cannot do that, because if you're a child of God, it says this is the mark of a child of God. Anything harmful, anything hurtful, anything destructive, anything that will put them down, anything that will kill them, anything that will destroy them, you cannot do that anymore, because it says that ye may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God, without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom ye shine as lights in the world. Holding forth, that's the mark now, that's the characteristic now, that's what you do now. Holding forth the word of life, that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain, neither labored in vain. That's the mark of a real child of God. It does something, that there's transformation in our lives. It does something, there's a real change in our lives. It tells us in Hebrews chapter 2, reading from verse 9. Hebrews chapter 2, reading from verse 9. It says, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. We should have died, because the Bible says, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And then it says, it tells us very clearly that the gift of God is life, eternal life. But the wages of sin is what? Is death. And here it says, he, that is Christ, he, that's our Savior, he, that's our Redeemer, he, that's the one who has died for us, he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. What's the purpose of that? Look at verse 10. In verse 10, it says, for it became him, that is, it befitted him, it suited him, for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing, who is he bringing? Many sons unto what? Unto glory. Bringing many sons unto glory. He leads us in the path of grace and glory. Not in disgrace. Not in a character that somebody will say, and you say you're a Christian. And you say you go to gospel church. And say you are in a Bible-believing church. He brings us to glory to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering. It tells us then what the character, what the lifestyle of a real child of God, of a real son of God is. It tells us in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 14, as obedient children, as obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former lusts in your ignorance. It says, if we have been called out of sin and called out of evil, if we're not children of God, it says, look at this one. We're not children who are obedient to the Father. We're not children who are obedient to the prompting of the Spirit. We're not children who are obedient to the commandments of the Lord, our Savior. And it says, as obedient children, we will not fashion ourselves, our lives, our character, our behavior according to the former laws. You see, the former lust we are talking about is not just your own personal former lust. For example, you come to live in a particular community. In that community, you know, you begin to make friends and, you know, interact with people, so you are not isolated. And the people there, they have their normal lifestyle. And it's a lifestyle that's not according to the word of God. And they're going to teach you, and they're going to tell you, and they're going to reveal to you that this is how we behave in this place. The former laws, you say, no, I'm born again now. I cannot do that. You go to work in the office, and in the office, they have their way of working to rule. They have their way of hiding the files somewhere, and then they're looking for bribe. They're looking for something, and they're checking all the piles of files they cannot find. And once you go to work in an office like that, and, you know, you come in with a kind of a new lifestyle, and you come in with, you know, we do the right thing at the right time to the right person, that's his right, bring out his file and give to him. The others are going to be talking to you, what's your problem? That you are going to walk in here, you think, well, depending on salary, we hide those files so that the people, when they are very serious about wanting to get what they want, they'll put their hands in the pocket and give us something, and we can be adding that to our salary. That's what we do here. It says, as you're walking there now, you cannot do that, because that's the former laws. You've been doing that before, but now you are a child of God. As obedient children, I pray the grace of God will be in our lives. But you see, if this is not there, if the difference is not there, if we're just like them, if we just act like them, then we're not sons of God, we're not daughters of God. It says, as obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to your former laws in your ignorance, but as he which has called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation, because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. You are going to be holy. Look at verse 22. See, ye have purified your souls in obeying the truth. That's the character of a child of God. It's not just like somebody says, I'm a child of God. You cannot tell the difference between him today and what he was many years ago. If there's a change, it says, you have done something. Through the blood of the Lamb, you've gone to Calvary, and it says you have purified your soul in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love, unpretending love, unhypocritical love, a sincere love, a transparent love, a practical love, that the person you love will know that this person loves me. Not something we say out of the mouth and doesn't come out in the character. It says, unto unfeigned love of the brethren, see that she love one another with a pure heart, fervently. Verse 23, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. I pray that word will show the mark in our lives in Jesus' name. It says in the passage we read in 1 John chapter 3, it says, now are we the sons of God? We were sons of wrath before. We were sons of Satan before. We were children of disobedience before. We were the children of wrath before, and the children of the devil, the sons of Belial, the sons of perdition. But now, after repentance, but now, after regeneration, but now, after the salvation in Christ, we become the sons of God. And a definite change has taken place. Without that change, any claim of sonship to God is self-deception. And if you go with that false claim and you die in that condition, it will be hellfire forever. There must be clear sign that you're a real child of God. Number one, genuine repentance. You know that you really repented, not just that, you know, you are whitewashed or, you know, you just deceive yourself. Okay, I repent, and then you cannot see the fruit of repentance. Number two, it's true faith in Christ. Your confidence is not in idols anymore. It's not in another religion anymore, and it's not in occultism anymore. It's not in an old man, old woman somewhere you're still going to, and then you're receiving whatever you're receiving from them, and you try to join Christ with the old false prophet. Nothing like that at all. You have total, complete, entirely, absolute faith in Christ, and a salvation and newness of life. Your life has become renewed, your life has become transformed, and you yourself can tell, your conscience can tell you, praise the Lord. You know, something happens and then you behave in a Christian way and you're almost pinching yourself and say, is that me? Is that me? I never knew I could keep calm and keep cool in a condition like that. Thank God, new life has come, and it's a witness of the Spirit, bearing witness with your heart. You are a child of God. There's victory over temptation. Victory over temptation. Any temptation that comes, the things that used to make you fall before, once nothing comes, maybe money, once nothing comes, maybe women, once nothing comes, maybe alcohol, once nothing comes, maybe the, you know, something oppressing in your heart to start fighting again. Once it came in the past, you couldn't overcome. But now, because of the grace of God, but now because you are a child of God, there's victory over temptation, and there is a freedom from your old sinful life. Freedom from the old sinful life. The things I used to love, I love them no more. The places I used to go, I go there no more. The things I used to wear, I wear them no more. The pride I used to manifest, I manifest that no more. I now live by the grace of God. I have love for God and love for His word. The word of God becomes, you know, your constant companion, and you're reading the word, you're believing the word, you're living by the word, and then there's obedience to God. This is the evidence that a change has taken place. You came from darkness, you came to the light. You came from death and you came to life. And now you have the marks of the sons of God. Point number two, the manifestation of the Savior from glory. Come to 1 John chapter 3. Verses 4 and 5. 1 John chapter 3, verse 4. It says, whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law. For sin is a transgression of the law. Whosoever, I want you to understand that word, whosoever. Even in our normal society, even in, you know, around us, in our country here, or any other country, when the law is made, the law is for everyone. There's no immunity for anyone. It means then that, you know, somebody is old, they say it's now, you know, like, you know, this number of years, and then there's another person that is young, and the law affects both of them. This one is a man, this one is a woman. The law affects both of them. This one is a man of authority in society, and this man is a common person in society. The law affects both of them. And the church, the same thing. The law of God has no respect for person. The law of God has no kind of exemption for anybody. The law of God is the law of God. Somebody says, you know, I am so and so in the church. Well, praise the Lord. That's a benefit. That's a privilege. That doesn't make you exceptional. That the law of God does not apply to you anymore. I am so useful. I'm so profitable. This is my position. This is my right. And this is my responsibility. You're still part of whosoever. Look at this. Whosoever committed sin transgresses also the law. We cannot have, you know, a kind of preservation for, you know, this person and that other person and that other person. And so we know they're in a special class, and the rest of us are the common people. We cannot do that. The law of God applies to everyone. And if you are kind of giving yourself an ivory tower where you lift up yourself and say, you know, you're doing something wrong, and your conscience is telling you, that's sin, that's evil, and then you say, yes, but this is who I am in the church, and this is what I am in the church, and they cannot touch me, because if they touch me, they know that this will suffer and this will suffer. It means that Christ cannot do his work without me. The Holy Ghost cannot do his work without me. Even the Heavenly Father, God Almighty, is helpless without me, because if I'm not there, what can God do? If I'm not there, what can Christ do? If I'm not there, what can the Holy Ghost do? And so, I am there. But you know what? Number one, that is blasphemy. You're telling yourself you're a blasphemous person. You're saying that you occupy such a place that the word of God does not matter to you. The commandments of God do not matter to you. And the requirement of God does not matter to you. And the disposition that you are carrying along is like, I am there, I am there. Of course, you know God can remove anybody. I say God can remove anybody. Cain felt, am I my brother's keeper? God dealt with him. And Pharaoh felt, who is that God? I don't know him. God dealt with him. Nebuchadnezzar said, here is Babylon that I built for the glory of my name. And God, you know, sent him to the forest before he learned his lesson. And Herod, God dealt with everyone. So I don't want you to have any idea, any impression that, you know, I'm here. And if I'm not there, then Jesus is helpless. You understand? You're blaspheming. If you're saying that, if you're thinking like that, because it says, whosoever committed sin is transgressing the law, for the sin is a transgression of the law. Look up here. You know, when we need to talk to ourselves as the church. You know, sometimes it may not even be you that is, you know, saying that. Already you have classified so and so like that. You have classified this group of people like that. You have classified this section of people like that. And, you know, you tell yourself if they're doing anything that you know is wrong. And you cannot justify that wrong. You're saying, well, but the church has to understand. The church has to just allow them to do what they do. Because after all, if they're not there, they are, you know, they all in all. If they're not there, God is helpless. If they're not there, Christ is helpless. If they're not there, the Holy Ghost is helpless. If they're not there, even the pastor cannot do anything. What can he preach? He knows doctrine, he knows Bible. But if he's, you know, if they are not there, he's totally helpless. Now you understand. And if when people like that, when they do evil, and the Bible says, them that sin, rebuke sharply, that they may fear. You are saying, what's the pastor doing? Doesn't the pastor understand that these people are greater than God? Doesn't the pastor understand that these people, they are untouchable? Because we ourselves, we have forgotten the Bible. I pray the Bible will come back to our church. I said the Bible will come back to our church, because it says whosoever committed sin transgresses also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law. And it says, and ye know that he was manifested. Thank God Christ has been manifested. Thank God Jesus Christ, our Savior, our Lord, has been manifested. It says, ye know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him is no sin. Christ came from glory for a purpose. Christ suffered, Christ bled, Christ died for a purpose. His blood was shed for a purpose. The purpose was to bruise Satan. The purpose was to destroy the power of the tempter. The purpose was to pay the penalty for our sins. And the purpose was to put an end to sinning. The purpose was to provide everlasting righteousness and purify us and make us ready and fit for heaven. He will do it in every life. Look at the purpose, well stated. We're looking at Matthew chapter 1. Matthew chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 21. Matthew chapter 1. Reading from verse 21. It says in verse 21, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for what will he do? Save his people from their sins. You understand that word? Save his people from their sins. When Jesus saves, he saves from sin. When Jesus heals, he heals from sicknesses. When Jesus delivers, he delivers from oppression. Think about the healings of Jesus. This person was blind and he healed him. Was the blindness still there? and this person is sinner, and Jesus saved him, will the sin still be there? No. But you know, people are saying today, when Jesus heals us, the sickness is no more there. When Jesus delivers us, the oppression is no more there. But when Jesus saves us, it's just that he gave us favor. It's just that he gave us a forgiveness. It's just that he pardoned us. But then the sin is still there. And many people don't understand. Salvation means that you are saved from sin. You are delivered from sin. You are rescued from sin. You are taken away from that sin. And the sin is taken away from you. If the sin is still there, you are not saved. If the lying is still there, you are not saved. If the evil, the violence is still there, you are not saved. Because thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. In John chapter 1, verse 29. John chapter 1, verse 29. The purpose why he came and the purpose why the Son of God was manifested, that he might take away our sin. And ye know that in him is no sin. In John chapter 1, verse 29. The next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him and says, behold the Lamb of God. What does he do? We taketh away the sin of the world. Jesus Christ came to take the sin of the people that believe him in the world. He came to take their sins away. And so, if your sin is still there, it's not been taken away. The reason for the manifestation of Christ has not been fulfilled in your life. Somebody might have made a mistake in putting you in a position of responsibility in the church. That doesn't matter. Position apart, salvation apart. The reason he was manifested is so that he will take our sins away. Somebody is still into witchcraft and he's doing this and doing that with a group of people and tormenting, torturing people among them there. It's not saved. It's not a child of God. Even though he says, I'm a worker, I'm a leader, I am this and that. And you know where you go in the night and you know what you do to other people when sins are taken away. You hate that sin. You reject that sin. You come out of that sin. That sin comes out of you. And you don't have any relationship in practice with that sin anymore. It says, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. Look at chapter 5 of John. John chapter 5. I'm reading from verse 14. John chapter 5, verse 14. Afterward, Jesus findeth him in the temple and says unto him, behold, thou art made whole. Sin no more. Somebody, can you shout that with me? Sin no more. I want to hear you. Sin no more. If you are not angry at the word of God and you are not saying, well, are they preaching like that? Where are you now? See no more. He says, see no more, lest a worse thing come unto thee. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. He said, I set you free. I released you from your sickness. I also released you from your sin. And you must not continue in sin. That's the evidence of God, the grace of God. That's the evidence you really belong to the Lord. Now you love the truth. Now you love righteousness. Now you love holiness. Now you love godliness. Now you love the word of God. It says, sin no more, lest it was sin come on thee. When you're a child of God, you sin no more. It's not just that you don't sin on Sunday, but you go to sin on Monday. Anytime in your life, every time in your life, the grace of God comes to you. And the Lord is reminding you all the time, sin no more, sin no more, sin no more, because the Lord has set you free. Look at John chapter 8, and I'm reading from verse 11. John chapter 8, verse 11, she said, no man, Lord. Jesus said unto her, neither do I condemn thee. What follows that? Go and sin no more. Go and drink no more. Go and fight no more. And go and do those evil things no more. You cannot do them again. If Christ is there, Satan is out. If righteousness is there, sin is out. If a freedom has come, bondage is gone out. If light has come in, darkness has gone away. And it says, neither do I condemn you, forgive you for the past, but now in the future, for the future, go and sin no more. And that's what the Lord has done, because he's brought in a better covenant. That is salvation. And even after salvation, there's something that is called sanctification. We're looking at Titus chapter 2, verse 14. Titus chapter 2, we're looking at verse 14. It says, who gave himself for us. It's talking about Christ, our substitute. Talking about Christ, the final sacrifice. It's talking about Christ, our Savior. It says, who gave himself for us. Talking about Christ, our sanctifier, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. He says, sanctified us, purified us, purged us, and now he purifies unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. He tells us in 1 Peter chapter 4. 1 Peter chapter 4, and I'm reading here from verse 1. 1 Peter chapter 4, reading from verse 1. For as much then as Christ has suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind. For he that has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, has stopped sinning. The career of sin has come to an end, has ceased from sin, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh to the laws of men, but to the will of God. It says there's a difference. No longer will he live in the flesh. No longer will he live in defilement. No longer will he live in any kind of evil. It says, for the time past of our life may suffice us to have wrought the will of the Gentiles. When we walked in the past in lasciviousness and lust and excess of wine and revelings and banquetings and abominable idolatries, wherein they think it strange that she run not with them to the same excess of riot, speaking evil of you. There's such a mighty change. We don't continue in the lives that were living in the past. 1 John chapter 1. In 1 John chapter 1, it tells us from verse 5. It says, this then is the message which we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. Amen. Amen. If we say in verse 6, we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. If we say we're in Christ, if we say we walk in the light and we're still in darkness, and we're covering up with darkness, in the darkness of occultism, in the darkness, anything I say, if I tell that a woman that pregnancy will not last, that a woman does not know me, it will be like that. You're still walking in darkness. If I look at somebody, and I look at him because he has offended me, and I even if I don't talk, and I say it will not be better for him, he will smell pepper. You're not a child of God if you're like that. If I don't like anybody because, you know, they did this and they did this, I will still find a way to methodically destroy them. Then you are not a child of God. You are walking in darkness. When somebody comes into the light, there's a total change. There's total transformation. And it says there that if we say we have fellowship with him, with Christ, who is the light, and we're still walking in darkness, we're lying and we're doing all the truth. Look at verse 7. But if we walk in the light, thank God I walk in the light. I said, thank God I walk in the light. And you know, it doesn't matter in the morning, afternoon, or evening. Doesn't matter you're in the family, outside the family. It doesn't matter you're in the office or you're in the church. It doesn't matter you travel out or you're traveling. It doesn't matter you are with women or you are with men. It doesn't matter you are with deeper like church people or you are with some other people who go to another church. It doesn't matter if you're a real child of God, you walk in the light. If they are not walking in the light and they say, well, this is business, and they say, well, this is, you know, tradition, and they say, well, this is our culture, and they say, well, this is our people, they say, you know, what we normally do over here, when you go back to your church, go and be like your church, but over here is what we do. You cannot be in darkness sometimes, then in the light, then in darkness, then in the light. Every time, if you're a real child of God, you'll walk in the light. I said you'll walk in the light, and you will let your light so shine before men. The other people there, if they are not in the light, totally in the light, completely in the light, they'll see a better light, a fuller light, a more glorious light through you in Jesus' name. If we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. We have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from some of our sins. I say from many of our sins, from all sin. And when you are cleansed from all sin, no sin will remain there. I said no sin will remain there. I want you to think about something now with me. As you look at the Old Testament, the Old Testament produced people like Enoch, people like Abraham, people like Moses, people like Joshua. Look at their lives. As you look at their lives from the time they met the Lord, or from the time the Lord met them and changed them, look at the tenor of their lives. You think of people like Samuel. Think of people like Ruth. Think of people like Elijah. Think of people like Mordecai. Think of people like Nehemiah, like Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel. Think of people like Daniel, like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They were not in the New Testament, Old Testament, under the Old Covenant. Look at the life they lived. Babylon, look at the life they lived. Joseph in Egypt, look at the life he lived. Joseph in the house of Potiphar, look at the life he lived. And Mordecai, when Haman was even threatening, is going to kill him and kill all the Jews, and yet he will not bow, and yet he will not succumb, and yet he will not compromise. Think about Daniel, and he said, if you continue praying like this, living a different life, you'll be thrown into the lion's den. Think about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and it's like, if you do not bow down to worship my idol, you'll be thrown into the fire. Old Testament people, look at how they stood. Look at how they were righteous. Now Christ has come. The Son of God is manifested, and he brought in a better covenant, and he brought in a higher covenant. And this is the time that those who say they are the Lord, as we look at all those Old Testament people, and Jesus has now come, it should produce something better in us. Something holier in us, something greater in us, something purer in us, something stronger, something freer, something lovelier than the Old Testament people. It will be done in your life. Because the purpose of Christ's manifestation is to produce a more glorious church than the Old Testament assembly, is to produce a more blameless church than the Old Testament congregation, is to produce a more sanctified church than the Old Testament group of people, is to produce a fearless church than the Old Testament people. I look at Daniel, and he feared nothing and feared nobody. You look at Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they are commission and their commandment of God and their commitment to the Lord and their covenant was the number one in their hearts. They saw the face, the furious face, and the angry face, and the violent face, and the murderous face of Nebuchadnezzar. It did not move them. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said, go ahead and do what you want to do. If it be so that you want to throw us into fire, let it be known unto you. We're not going to bow down to your idol. They're not like people who bow down to idol today because of job, because of money, because of marriage, and the compromise, and everything they have learned from the time they said they were born again. When it comes to the time of marriage, when it comes to the time of paying dowry, not paying dowry, when it comes to the time of reception or no reception, everything crumbles and they cannot stand anymore. But Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego faced the fire, and he said, whatever the fire, whatever the fury, we're going to serve the Lord, and he served the Lord. If Jesus Christ died on the cross to give us a greater experience, a higher experience, a higher salvation, a better salvation, and he died on the cross so that we can have more commitment and submissiveness and heavenly mindedness and spirit-filled, rapturable life, I believe that we shall be more than the Old Testament people. We're not going to succumb again. We're not going to compromise again. We're going to live according to the standard of the Word of God in Jesus' name. Let the church say amen. Amen. Point number three, the marvel of true salvation. with godliness. The marvel of true salvation with godliness. We're coming to 1 John chapter 3, and I'm reading from verse 9. 1 John chapter 3, verse 9. It says, whosoever, that's the word again, whosoever, if you're really born again, this will describe your life. Whosoever, if you're a real child of God, this will describe your life. Whosoever, if you're a real child of God, this will be in your consciousness. Anything in the world, anything even in the church, will not matter to you. This will be the number one thing. This will be your watchword. This will be your very heart. You say everything can go. Your friends can leave you. This one must stay. All the privileges you have, they may take that away, but this one will stay. And whether this happens or that does not happen, they love you, they hate you, they accept you, they reject you, this must be there, because this is the real thing, the central thing, the indispensable thing that Jesus Christ came for. Whosoever is born of God does not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin because he's born of God. Then he tells us in this, the children of God are manifest, the children of God are revealed, the children of God are visible to be seen, they are manifest, and the children of the devil, whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. Look at 1 John chapter 5. I'm reading from verse 18. 1 John chapter 5. We're looking at verse 18. We know that whosoever, that's the word again, whosoever is born of God sinneth not. No, he does not practice sin. No, he does not say, this is my peculiar sin. This the sin I love. I cannot give up this. I cannot give up that. It means, I don't believe the totality of the word of God. But you say that we know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not. But he that is begotten of God keepeth himself. The Lord will keep you. The power of God will keep you. The grace of God will keep you. Keepeth himself, and that wicked one toucheth him not. I thought you'll say amen. He will not touch you in Jesus' name. You see, when we are born again, life becomes different. We do not continue in the sins of the old life anymore. Romans chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 1. Romans chapter 6, verse 1. It says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? What's the answer? God forbid. Some people say grace, 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 and because of that, they continue in sin. Those are the people that turn the grace of God into lasciviousness. Those are the people that abuse and misuse the grace of God. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? We are dead to sin. We're not going to live in that sin anymore. Look at verse 6. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him. Read it to understand. Knowing this, that our old natural carnal nature is crucified with him. Look at this. It says, knowing this, that our old depravity is crucified with him. You know, the thing that made us to do what we used to do. The things that made us to say the wrong things we used to say. The thing, the magnet that was pulling us and drawing us to go to the wrong direction and to go to the wrong thing and to do the wrong thing. All that is crucified. Knowing this, that our old man, our old nature, that old magnet, that old depravity is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be what? Pampered? Tolerated? Hidden? No. What does it say? Destroyed. When the body of sin is destroyed, the root of sin is destroyed, the very nucleus of sin is destroyed, sin will no longer be there. It says that henceforth we should not serve sin. Look at verse 7. For he that is dead is free from sin. He that is dead is freed from sin. Look at verse 12. It says, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body. If you have met Christ, if you have encountered Christ, if Calvary has worked in your life, if something definite, salvation, has taken place there, it says, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey it in the laws thereof. Neither yield your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God, for sin shall not have dominion over you. Can you personalize that? 1, 2, 3, go. For sin shall not have dominion over me. Can you say that confidently? If you know the grace of God is going to operate in your life, can you say that again? Sin shall not have dominion over you in Jesus' name. Hey, look at verse 16. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves, servants to obey, is servants ye are to whom ye obey. You see, when you do something wrong and do something wrong and do something wrong, it becomes a habit. It's like a little thread when you started it, and then another thread is joined to that, another thread is joined to that, until it becomes a heavy rope that you cannot break easily. But today, the grace of God and the fire of the Holy Ghost will burn that rope in Jesus' name. And then you will not continue to yield anymore. Know ye not that whom ye yield yourselves, servants to obey, is servants ye at whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. But God be thanked that ye were servants of sin, but ye have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered unto you. Obedience will take the place of disobedience. Constant obedience to the word of God. Implicit obedience to the word of God. Wholehearted, absolute obedience to the word of God. Then it goes on in verse 18. Being then made free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness. The power of God makes us free, and the strength of the Lord keeps us free. Look at verse 22. But now, being made free from sin and become servants to God, ye have your fruit unto holiness and the end everlasting life. I pray that will happen in Jesus' name. You know, even in the Old Testament, the Lord was anticipating and looking forward to this new age and to this new era and to this new dispensation and to this time when those who have come to the Lord, they'll be totally holy and righteous, and they will not continue the sins of the past. We're looking at Psalm 4. Let's read it from verse 3. It says, but know that the Lord has set apart him that is godly for himself. Not for Satan, for himself. Not for the world, for himself. Not even for self. He has set apart him that is godly for himself. The Lord will hear when I call unto him. Look at verse 4. Stand in awe and sin not. Commune with your own heart upon your bed and be still. You see there, it says, sin not, you will not sin. I said you will not sin. Verse 5, only then can you come and offer the sacrifices of righteousness and put your trust in the Lord. In Psalm 119, I'm reading from verse 1. In Psalm 119, verse 1, blessed are the undefiled in the way who walk in the law of God. Those are the children of God. Those are the people who have met Christ. Those are the people whose lives have been changed and transformed. It says, blessed are they are undefiled in the way. They walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are they that keep his testimonies and that seek him with the whole heart. Look at verse 3. They also do no iniquity. Amen. They do no iniquity in the day, in the night. They do no iniquity in the church, in the service. They do no iniquity in the house fellowship. They do no iniquity in the street, in the market. They do no iniquity in their offices. They do no iniquity in their homes. They do no iniquity. They also do no iniquity. They walk in his ways. How does that happen? Look at verse 11. Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. That habit of sinning, the Lord will crush it. The Lord will take it away. And real righteousness will be in the life of every one of us claiming to know the Lord and to be with the Lord in Jesus' name. New Testament, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 34. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, reading from verse 34. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 34. It says, awake to righteousness and sin not. That's the New Testament standard. That's the result of Calvary. That's the result of Christ coming into our lives and making the sacrifice that he made. That's the difference between us and the people who have not met Christ. The difference between us and the people who do not know the Lord. When you have met the Lord and the grace of God has taken place in your life and taken its proper place in your heart, it says, awake to righteousness and see not, for some have not the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. I was talking to the Corinthians, those people that remained in their evil, and they did not understand that salvation will bring righteousness and godliness. But the Lord has revealed to us salvation, righteousness, salvation, godliness. They go together. They'll go together in your life. Titus chapter 2, Titus chapter 2, verse 11. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared unto all men. The grace of God bringing salvation has appeared unto all men. It says that teaching us that we should deny ungodliness and worldly lusts, and we should live soberly and righteously and godly in this present world. I pray this will be our experience in Jesus' name. Say 1 Timothy chapter 6. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 6. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 6. But godliness with contentment is great gain. Godliness with contentment. If you have contentment, you are not going to be fighting over anything. You know, in the church, you have this privilege. That's enough. You're not going to fight over, I must do something else, do something else. And then I must compete with the men and compete with the women. No competition. There'll be contentment. In your home, there'll be contentment. In your office, there'll be contentment. In the community in which you live, there'll be contentment. You're not fighting anybody. You're not struggling with anybody. You're not contending with anybody. You know that the greatest thing that can happen to you is to have salvation and to prepare to get to heaven. And once you lose heaven, whatever else you gain here in the world is nothing. So you are not looking for, I must have this, I must have that, and all those things that make people to lose their very lives. But godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain that we can carry nothing out. And having food and raiment, let us be therewith content. But they that will be rich by all means, they that will be rich by force, and they that will be rich, they fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and hurtful laws, will drown men in perdition and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all evil. The love of money is the root of all evil. If you love any other thing apart from God, with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind, if it's position you love, it's going to get you into trouble. If it is, you know, pride you love, it's going to get you into trouble. If it is this material thing or that material thing you love, it's going to get you into trouble. If it's money or whatever money can buy is on the top of your heart, it gets you into trouble. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from their faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. But thou, O man of God, flee these things and follow after righteousness. Here is the word: godliness, faith, love, patience, and meekness. I pray the Lord will effect it in every life in Jesus' name. We're looking at 2 Peter, 2 Peter chapter 1, 2 Peter chapter 1. I'm reading from verses 3 and 4. 2 Peter chapter 1. And we read from verses 3 and 4. Here is what the Lord has given us according as his divine power. He has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. He has given unto us all things that pertain to life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that has called us to glory and to virtue, whereby are given unto us great, exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that's in the world through lust. I pray every one of us will escape in Jesus' name. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 11, godliness that should go along with the salvation we profess and the salvation we say that we have. It tells us in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 11, seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, 12. What manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness? All the things in the world are going to be dissolved. All the material things dissolved. All the physical things totally dissolved. And then it says, when all those things have gone and there's no material thing anymore, what should we have? And the thing we should concentrate on today, it is to have holy conversation and godliness. Verse 12, looking for and hastening unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that ye look for such things, be diligent. I'll be diligent. We'll be diligent. Be diligent that ye may be found of him in peace, without spot and blameless. The Lord is coming. And when he comes, there's something he'll be looking for. When he comes, there's something he wants to see in your life, in every one of our lives. He tells us in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14, Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14. It says in verse 14, follow peace with how many people? All men, and holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. Holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. We're waiting for his kingdom. We're waiting for his arrival. And we need grace in our lives that we'll be totally saved, completely saved, and no sin will remain in our lives in Jesus' name. We'll be higher and better and freer, holier than the people in the old covenant in Jesus' name. And the grace of God will be more abundant in our lives in Jesus' name. Look at verse 28 of that, Hebrews chapter 12. It says, wherefore, we receive in a kingdom which cannot be moved. Let us have grace. Let us have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. I pray that that godliness will be in every life, and that Christ will come into our lives afresh and then do a work that everybody will know that we're real children of God, and the grace of God and the goodness of God and the holiness and the righteousness and the purity of the Lord will be in every one of our lives in Jesus' name. You will be rapturable. I said you'll be rapturable. And every man that has this hope in him purifies himself even as he is pure. Let him do a great work of grace in your heart today before you go. So that life will become better, richer, deeper, higher, and brighter in the grace of God in Jesus' name. Let's rise up now and talk to the Lord in prayer and say, Lord, here we are today. We want grace to come more abundantly in our lives. We want Calvary to touch our lives once again. We want a greater transformation than we ever had before. And whenever Christ will come, we want to be ready. Open your mouth and pray. He'll make you ready.